Hi, sorry, welcome to today's panel on life, time and space in the 21st century. While everyone's just getting ready, I'd like to remind you that you can make your voice heard by participating on Twitter or via Wissembly. If you haven't already connected, there should be a postcard on your chairs which will tell you how to fire questions in our direction and generally let us know whether we're being interesting enough. So they'll be sent to me by the social media team, and I have a little little tablet here, and I'll then pass them on to make sure we get the message. Could you use the hashtag for this room, which is OECD Red? Should be fairly easy to remember. So just questions or comments or however you want to participate. It'd be great to have your contribution. If everyone's ready. Hi. My name's Robert Colville. I'm a journalist. I've just written a book called The Great Acceleration, which is about how life is getting faster and faster, and this, of course, includes the office. And I've got with me three people who have, in very different ways, made it their mission to sort of try to understand what's happening in the workplace and how to fix it, how to make sure that we have the best possible lives within offices and the companies we work for get the best of us. On my left is Sylvia Mattei. She's the CEO of Corporate Services Worldwide at Sodexo. So she oversees 120,000 staff with 5 billion euros in revenues. And but more importantly for our purposes, she also helps oversee the quality of life service that Sodexo provides. So they're, rather than just sort of saying that this is what's quite good for your company, they're doing real research into how, you know, what sort of things you should be doing for your staff, what delivers real results, and this is being done in association with the OECD. To my right is Holly Niemela, who is an extremely experienced teacher in mindfulness and emotional intelligence. She's been doing this for 28 years. You may have attended her workshops earlier or listened to her speak. She's one of 100, I love this, she's one of 100 worldwide certified teachers of the Google developed program Search Inside Yourself, the unexpected path to success and happiness at work. And finally, we have Raphael Gilgan, who is the head of research and trend scouting at Vitra. So his life is about thinking of ideas for making the office a better place, especially in terms of architecture, technology, looking at how the working world is changing, what impact that's having on existing business models. He travels all over the world, but lives on a farm in the Bavarian woods. Is that right? So he's got that work-life balance thing absolutely nailed. So let's start. The title of this session has to do with work and life and time and space, and it sort of feels like the main issue is having time to have a life and finding the space to do it. I mean, I've got some statistics here. So 94% of workers have said they are overwhelmed by information to the point of incapacitation. Two-thirds of them say they don't have enough time. There's 40% say they feel guilty about taking a day off. The number of people who are working more than 50 hours a week in America is up now to sort of it's increased by a huge amount over the last 30 years. Only 56% of Americans actually take a week's holiday in a given year. Sylvia, let's start with you. Is there a sense that the working world, as I kind of say in my book, is moving too fast, that there's more sort of pressure on people there's more of a sort of treadmill effect taking place? Or are we seeing the beginnings of a backlash?
So first of all, I'm going to say that I'm very nervous speaking to all of you, so that's my stress quotient going up. But I'm going to speak about something that I'm passionate about, which is that the quality of life of people at work does have a direct impact on the economic progress of the organizations for which they work. And the issue that companies are facing is that those numbers that you've just given translate into something like only 33% of people at work are committed to their companies. So yes, there is obviously the sense that things like loyalty, being attached to a company, wanting to work for the progress of a company is changing. And there's also a real desire for companies to attract talent. So there's correspondingly a disaffection for work, but a real battle for talent. So the question is, how can you reconcile the two? I'll give you another statistic which really surprised me. I read that 82% of company CEOs in the US believe that engagement of their employees is linked to their strategic objectives and their being able to reach their strategic objectives. And my thought was, what are the other 18% thinking? You know, how there are 18% of company CEOs out there who think it doesn't matter. And actually, it does matter. And in Sodexo, you gave some numbers, but above where I work, we're present on 33,000 sites. We see on 33,000 sites in 60 countries how people work. We have, you know, 120,000 people working in my division, 340,000 worldwide. We have people every day talking to us about engagement. And that paradigm has got to shift if we want to be able to continue. We're really, I think, at a cliff situation about having people work and make sure that they are engaged and productive for their companies.
Thanks, Holly, and would you like to respond to that?
Well, I'm coming from a totally different place and space, maybe. I've been teaching yoga and meditation, emotional intelligence and mindfulness for a very long time, as you stated. And so I'm coming from the sense of the individual. I think that to kind of fall back on what you said in the beginning, I think I'm teaching people to have the time of their lives. And in the sense of getting into their potential and their optimal way of being. Now, in the last few years, I've been asked to come into companies, and for me, the company is a whole new place and space. I've only worked in a digital startup in the 80s, a digital startup, yes, that existed. Which was, you know, fantastic place. But then I realized that wasn't the work that I wanted to take upon in my career. So when I go to companies, I'm always a little overwhelmed at first by the amount of suffering that I'm meeting, the amount of disengagement, the amount of absenteeism, the amount of mental health problems. All unaddressed, the amount of meanness sometimes, with each other. And so my work has really been about bringing very soft skills to companies. And, you know, my yogic and meditation training has given me a great opportunity to work with hundreds, probably thousands of individuals over 28 years to bring these very simple skills that now, thank God, are being highly regarded as not, you know, orange robes, Buddhist, religious connotation, but important soft skills to change our work life. Let's say, work-life balance. For me, it's not that anymore. I think we should erase that and come into, as we are going into in this millennium, is about individual consciousness. And each individual, I think, is going to have to learn in some way or another this sense of awareness. And this awareness of oneself, it starts with ourselves to then add to changing the workplace. How do I deal with my coworker who I don't like? If you were in my discussion earlier, I don't know if people were surprised or not, because I said, well, send them kindness. Take 2 minutes every morning when you get to the office with that person that you really have a difficult time with. You don't have to tell them you're doing it, but just take 2 minutes and breathe, concentrate, and send feeling in your body. It has to be authentic. Just kindness. That person doesn't suffer. I hope she doesn't suffer. I hope that her health is good. I hope that she's happy. It might sound really crazy, but it does work. This is something they do at Google.
So if you're at Google and suddenly everyone starts being really nice to you, you should get a bit worried.
No, it's not that being really nice. No, you know, it's a way. Let's talk about the neurological aspect of that. Is when you are actually becoming more self-aware. So which is the first attribute of emotional intelligence. You are also, the research from Tanya Singer at the Planck Institute in Germany has showed that your level of empathy is also increasing because it's the same part of the brain that's being activated and being strengthened. So we're talking, I'm not talking about, this is what I'm doing in companies now, is helping them, leaders to also the people on the, what's that called, the industrial chain, you know, where people are just doing these repetitive jobs. Where are they getting meaning? It's not just for their leaders, it's for everybody in the workforce to understand in one way or another, how can I become more aware? More awareness leads to more happiness. Okay, so there's a lot of different questions about how do we teach that to 420,000 people? I think I'm all for the digital age there and saying let's put it on online. You know, get some human teachers as well, but some online things.
And Raphael?
Yeah, I believe since latest with the last crisis, the people are disconnected to their company because at the end of the industrial age, where efficiency was the most important point, we lose a lot. We only work in this generic repetition from quarter to quarter, and now we have no idea. And I believe the one of these characters for tomorrow, it's about creativity. But think about creativity. What is before creativity? Maybe curiosity is full of creativity. And think about in your own company, in your surrounding, what's about curiosity there? Yeah. How often we ask ourselves things, how often we challenge our own status quo and say, is that the right way to do that? Let us go for another perception. And so we squeeze it out at the end of the industrial economy, we squeeze it totally out, and now there's nothing there. And maybe all the assets are gone. All these corporate assets are gone, maybe. Yeah. So what is the cultural glue of the company? And now the race begins now. But what makes a difference is, 100 years ago, maybe only 8 or 15 countries was at the line to start the race through the industrial economy. Now maybe 100 or more countries are standing on the same line because it's possible in terms of digitalization.
I mean, speaking of digitalization, obviously a big part of this is technology. I mean, I imagine everyone sitting in this room here has a mobile phone in their pocket. I imagine everyone sitting in this room here checks their email on it about once a minute, even when they're at home. I mean, if I asked you if you'd be willing to sort of hand in your mobiles during the course of this meeting, you probably wouldn't do it, and indeed it would mean you couldn't tweet your thoughts. So we'd be very disappointed in that. But I mean, there's a sense here, isn't there, that of what sort of to paraphrase Mr. Juncker, you know, we all know what we need to do, but we just don't know how to survive it. You know, we all know that. Partly this is about just the work never goes away.
I have a slightly different personal take on technology. As a working mother, I think it's what allowed me to have a career and 3 children and be able to not sort of off-ramp, on-ramp. And I'm very grateful to technology for that. I think it also allows people to be more flexible in the time that they take for work, and that's something that's really number one for a lot of, especially younger workers, being able to work when they want. But I think the technology crunch that you're talking about and dehumanization of it is working all the time and never being able to switch off. But I think there we have to get discipline and we have to be able to disenfranchise ourselves from technology. I also see technology as being very difficult in the workplace when we're talking about manufacturing workplaces. And I was reminding the panel earlier that not everybody works in offices. So when you imagine manufacturing sites, which are highly automated, very geared towards the drumbeat of the machine, and you have people, how do you reconcile that piece of the worker and the highly automated lines? And then I think another thing that I notice, and I notice in my clients, is that because people use technology to work outside of a specific space, it's very hard to know as a manager if people are working or not. And I believe that because we're measuring people on output, we tend to be unfair about the output that we ask them. So we're not seeing you work, therefore we're just piling on work, piling on work, piling on work, and there's no way to say stop. So there's, you know, I'd say, you know, my daughter works for Google, actually. She's always wanted to work for Google. I'd say technology is what it is. But what we probably haven't done and haven't had the maturity to do is learn how to harness it or how to work with it so that we're not completely consumed by it.
I'd say exactly that is what I'm trying to teach, is this idea of being so connected is, what are we connected to? You know, these devices that every bell, whistle, and, you know, message that pops up is attracting our attention. It's actually taking our attention away from what we want to do. What do we want to do? And I say to people, how are you leading your life? And the idea is that if we don't become savvy and realize that every time we go and pick up that phone, why do we want to pick it up? I don't. You said every minute we are checking our mails? You're 35, right? So, okay. Anyway, you know why we're doing it? Anybody know the neurological reason why? We're getting dopamine every time we do that. We're getting a little drug every time we pick up and we have a bling bling, a message, a text to our email. Yes. So it's hard, you know? To put you all into a getting out of this addiction to, you know, what are they calling it now? Digital detox. I teach a lot of that. I don't call it that because I think that's corny, but actually it's true. And this is a problem, a brain drain, because 47% of the time we are off, hors sujet, we are offline. We're not connected to what's happening in this moment. And if I'm not I'm not connected to what's happening in this moment, where am I? I then come back into the conversation and I have to take 60 seconds for my brain to refocus, to get to be completely aligned, my body, my emotions, my mind, my intelligence, physical intelligence, emotional intelligence, and IQ intelligence, so that I'm at my full potential and be able to respond and perform where I should and how I should. Okay, so 47% of the time, if we're off, just think of that. This kind of training, that mindfulness, and why has it become made such big waves in the world? Yesterday at one of the digital conferences, all they were talking about was soft skills. We have to develop soft skills and leadership skills. Thank God, because this is really what's going to change. It's going to help to change, I believe, our workplace and our whole life. Our whole life. You don't stop being you know, conscious because you leave work. It's a skill for humanity.
So, Raphael, can I just move things in a slightly different direction? Because just picking up on the point about flexibility and your work. I mean, this we're talking sort of immediately now about technology, but you see things changing sort of kind of much more dramatically over the next few decades, to the point where the idea of the office as the space where we all go kind of. That paradigm, which is so central to our lives, might not be there anymore.
So for our work, for our self-work, so we give our guidance by questions. As better the questions are, as better is the result. There's one question, it is, what remains at the end of the analog world? Maybe if everything is going digital, so maybe in 20 years, what remains at the end of the analog world? What are the artifacts around us where we are hardwired to? So that help us to understand how we create a physical space first. So the other question is, how do we do business, whatever, in age of uncertainty? Because the uncertainty is the new normal. It's like a quarter-wise uncertainty. And from this side, and the other point is, if you think in people first, then you have maybe a tool set to think about how influence technology that. And I think what we have to learn is, whatever the technology is, what is a cultural change in terms of my habits, about my behavior? And we have to learn to handle the transfer time. If anybody here in the space has a car which can park by themselves, maybe you don't use it because you don't accept it today. But to go with a driverless car, we first have to accept that the car goes by themselves to the garage. So that is a transfer time. That is normal. So when we understand and accept this transfer time, we will be much more open for technology from another way, not in an absolute way, that it is and that it isn't. And with that openness, one inside, with our experience from the past and maybe the expectation of tomorrow, we can build step by step a new environment. And sure, I don't believe that the kids which are born today look, no, with the kids which are in kindergarten today, they don't will look in a smartphone and they don't will look in a PC. Their life, it's not 16 to 9. Our own whole life here is 16 to 9. We look in these machines and that will totally disappear maybe in 8 or 9 years because information is around us. But think about what will be analog. Are there still cool old buildings in our European heritage? Think about the values of Europe, of these old cities. We have to take care about culture and combine these elements with the new ones.
I have a, sorry, I'm going to jump in.
I was
going to
ask you.
Well, as I listen to you and I think of this world of digital, I really think we have to think about the digital divide. And, you know, there's the whole part of the workforce, which is about being connected, always on, digital, etc. And as they get to be more important, what's happening to the workforce that needs to be in a constrained environment, that needs to remain in a manufacturing site, that needs to be on call in a hospital, that needs to be teaching 9 to 5? And how are we creating two types of employment, one that's very constrained to a place and another that's very free? And we have to think of that because I do believe that people might not want to work in things that are very important even for our future because they will not have that ability to be flexible. I'd like to make a pitch, I'm sorry, because I see my consumers and my clients every day. There's something that's mind-blowing to me. I see the people who use the cell phones, people who use the iPads, the people who are connected, who have all of that benefit of technology. And then I see the people who work in data centers. I see the life that you have in a call center. I see the other end of the chain in terms of employment. And if you look at it end to end, there's an even greater divide between those who benefit from what's being out there and those who have to work in those constrained environments to be able to support the digital revolution.
If I could give direct answer. I don't know who was in the morning
ladies
here.
Ladies first.
Ah, sorry, ladies first. But okay. Sorry. I don't know who was attend in the morning the lecture of Alejandro, the architect from Chile, who is a Pritzker Prize winner, who talk about architecture from a total other way, who talk about of the architecture about these people who are not able to spend any money for architecture. What we have to change is, wherever the workplace is, it should never be missing quality in this workplace, whatever the people do. And I believe it isn't a question of money to invest in a surrounding, because we are not connected to architecture, we are connected to nature. And that are easy patterns. If you understand the patterns of biophilic design or biophilia, you can create with less money a great space.
Okay, I'm going to go back to Sylvia because I have a question because I meet probably more busy executives and managers and the C-suite who are, say, they take advantage of the digital, you know, but most of them are saying, well, at night when they go to bed, I say, well, what are you thinking about? What's the last thing you do? I'm looking at my iPhone. Ooh. And, well, how are you feeling? Like, what did I do today? And I call that full plate empty life syndrome. Now, if I'm going to go, say, meet the guys who are working on the assembly line, I don't know. I don't, unfortunately, yet have a lot of those as clients, but I'd like to change that. But are they going home? Are they having a fuller life? What's the quality of how they're feeling?
So it's one of the hardest things to measure. It's quality of life in a manufacturing environment. What we notice is that there's a real, when you start really looking at it and doing the research, things that are very important to plant managers are not the things that are important to people on the line. And I'll give you what we call moments of truth or times to connect. So for instance, having a break. It's absolutely clear. Most plant managers will tell you having a break is key to productivity. Plus, it's legal, right? So they will have the breaks. Not very many people think about what that break should be. How do you create an environment where people can take 40 minutes, 20 minutes of time off a line and completely resource themselves? How in a, you know, if you see in a manufacturing site, usually not created for that. So the time of the break. And then you also notice that there's two very important moments in a manufacturing day, which is how do you get to your site? How long does it take you to get on site, to change into your uniform? How does that make you feel? So for instance, I have a client and I explain to them that they have a workforce which is on average, you know, has been working 10 to 15 years for that site. And every day they get searched by security. Every day they get searched by security when they come in and when they come out. How does that make you feel? You know, what's the meaning of that, right? So there's a time when you come on, and then there's how do you fluidify so that people can get offline? So they've been working on their shift, and sometimes it'll take them 45 minutes to get out of the parking lot. See, these are things when you say that it's not expensive, you're right, that's not an investment. That's actually an investment in time, in thinking about the people, what makes the meaning in their day, and what are, we call it, you know, one of our pillars of quality life, ease and efficiency. How do you make it easier for them to come in and to come out? Which is something completely disconnected from an office, because an office, you don't even go there every day, right?
So now I'd like to pick the panel up on something, which is you've been talking about these solutions, but whose responsibility is it? Mm. I mean, if you say, you know, recently, I mean, I think everyone saw this, there was a sort of a proposal that if people are working more than 50 hours a week in France, that their company has to have a policy on email use, has to have a sort of a thing it has to sort of just at least make a vague token effort to tell people that they shouldn't check their email. And this was reported with sort of gales of derision, really, around the world, that, you know, those crazy French, they're trying to stop us checking our email in the evenings. Don't they know how the modern workplace works? I mean, if all the stuff that we're saying is true, and we kind of think it is, that you get the best results when your people are most happy and most engaged, then can't we just leave it to the market to do that? That the companies that do this will get more profits, so everything will move in that direction. Or do we need government to step in? Or can change only come from within?
Well, I think it comes from the company. The most savvy companies that I'm working with are hot on this. This is the way to go. They understand they need to invest in these kinds of practices and trainings of soft skills, because they know that. In the end, the performance of the individual, which is measurable, changes. Absenteeism goes down, presenteeism goes down, and the employee engagement as well. Not even mention attracting talent, because the millennials, they come to work for an experience. They collect experiences, not things. And the sooner we understand a little bit about that, the more that you're going to attract these kinds of people. Why does everybody want to go work at Google? All these kids want to go work at Google or other of those kinds of companies because they have policies that are directed towards their well-being, and they'll work.
Now, sure, but not everyone can work at Google. Quite a lot of people, as Sylvia has reminded us, are working in factories or as nurses or right.
Stimulate other companies to hear about these stories so they start saying, uh-huh, and these CEOs will start saying, yeah, we need to invest, we need to change, we need to, this is the trend, no? I don't know, Raphael. Yeah.
I will come back to my first quote when I talk. We are coming back from this time of efficiency and perception. So in the times of efficiency, in terms of environment, regarding to business model, that was a function. It was a function. Okay, think now about the business models of tomorrow or how the business models are changing. Now, the environment is a key factor for the business model. If you go around the world now, the leading companies in the world invest now in their own environment. They build a campus. The huge companies build a campus. The little ones build a single building. But the single building is like an own urbanism with all these functions you want to have in your surrounding. If you live in an arrondissement in Paris, if you live in Berlin in a Kiez, or if you're in New York in a district. So that changed first. And if you understand that, then the objectives by the HR department, by the finance department, by the management is the same. So, and the other thing is how important it is to get a picture of tomorrow for the company. What is the future story of the company to get the same picture? And that thinking by the users of the products, of the services. What are the future market stories or customer stories? And how we could serve them best with our environment, if it is a production site or even an office building. And now I want to go more than 100 years back. With beginning with the industrialization in Germany, where I was born, I'm half German, half Spain, the owners of the factories, they built the factories, they built the kindergarten, they built the schools, the sport facilities, and all the things you need. These things are more than 100 years old, and we forget this totally. And now Mark Zuckerberg has to show us up in the US how to deal with that. It was an European idea. No. Sorry for that. Every time when I come back with the airplane, going home, it's like I land in the history. Sure, I'm really proud about the values of Central Europe, or our heritage, but we have to understand to transfer also these patterns, these tools in the next century. And that is up to us.
I agree. I just want to say, even though I am half American, half Finnish, but living in France for 28 years, I'm not promoting just a Google-ish setup. I think that each company, each culture needs to be anchored into their culture, their being, and create that. Now, I'm interested to know for Sodexo, how do they see it? They're global. So how are you going to, how do you see that?
Well, a first thought as I was listening to this is what we deeply need is insight and the recognition that the world has changed and that we don't know everything and that we need insight. We need to understand how consumers actually see their world everywhere in different countries. So we operate in 60 countries. Can I tell you how a Finn would react to an environment rather than in a person in India? Honestly, I would have an assumption, not sure it's the right one. But this is where technology can help us. This is where correct research can help us. This is why we're working with the OECD, because we can't bake solutions if we don't have facts. Now, the experience shows, and I've been working on this for many, many years, that it takes a long time. Because it's actually global, it's diverse, there's all kinds of different assumptions. So we might have to do some shortcuts along the way and just assume that these things are right. But I know for ourselves, you know, when you have 420,000 employees serving clients every day, the value of our service is in the human connection. And so if we have people who are who are doing presenteeism or who are absent, I mean, it's like we have nothing, right? If we can't grab this and make our employees be every day getting up and thinking, yes, I want to serve clients at a very low pay, by the way, because it's the nature of the service industry, then we as a company are dead, right? So this has actual meaning for us. Which is why we've been working on all these different aspects, what we call the pillars of quality of life, how we can engage people, make them have meaning. And I'll give you an example, which is, I saw this last week in Chile. Some bright spark invented a new kitchen concept. That's technology, right? But the really interesting thing about that concept is that the people who were in the kitchen, now, rather than spending all their time in the kitchen cooking, they can spend time in the restaurant interacting with their clients, right? And just that, over 3 years, has driven engagements up 10 points. 10 points of engagement. Can you imagine how much that's worth to a company? So the challenge for us is now, how do you take that from, you know, 3 sites where it started off to 80 sites where we're deploying now, to 33,000 sites. And I think when we talk about what's good or bad about technology, how you can get people connected, we talked about online training, being able to associate deep insights from a local basis and being able to bring that up into a data set that you can then deploy globally, that is what's going to make the difference.
although I think we shouldn't underestimate the role of national culture. I was sort of reminded of a holiday I went on, which where half the party was French and half the party was English, and when we all did exactly the same kind of jobs, and the only difference between our lifestyles was that the French people all took an hour to go and have a proper lunch, and the English people all went and grabbed a sandwich and pret a manger and ate it at the desk.
Yay, French!
I'm half French and half English, right? So I feel it fighting every day.
But I mean, there's a question. So to play devil's advocate here, I mean, what there are some people who like to keep work and life separate. They like to go in, do their job, go home, and then go and look after their families and not think about work. And it strikes me that quite a lot of the fashions in workplace engagement is about sort of blending the two. I mean, so some of the most successful firms do, you know, there's a wonderful study where a firm called Amoco realized that its staff were working too hard. So they invested, you know, everyone was complaining about their long hours, and they invested massive amounts in flexible working. They told everyone it's okay to go home, and yet no one did. And it turned out that actually it was much better being at the office doing intelligent, creative, thrilling things than being at home arguing about whose turn it was to change the diapers. Oh. Now, you know, it strikes me that there is, you know, companies like, you know, Google, if having sort of workshops on, you know, life skills and a thing, you know, it's great. But is there a danger that the type of firm, I mean, Raphael, you were describing with, you know, where you've got the company kindergarten, the company crash, and everything, you know, you become a company person in quite a deep way.
That is, at the end, that belongs to us, I think. That should be our own responsibility to how we want to handle that first. But to your back to your idea, if everything is fancy, so I don't believe that the other point is a company has to think about what is their DNA and what that means for terms of a space and an architecture. It's like if you think about your friends, if you visit them at home, they're all looking different, but they reflect their personality. They tell stories. It is a destination. And you think there and think, oh, it's interesting what they have there and so. And I think we should do one thing. First, there are no boundaries. In the future, will there be less boundaries between architecture-wise? A hotel, a bar, an office, and retail shop. Because we, the community, want to reflect our own design. Like me with my sneakers and my pants I wear. And that is, we will reflect that also in the architecture. And that will change a lot. It's not, Google make a huge step. And honestly, thanks for Google, 10 years ago, when they start that program, because they bring pressure to the market. Anybody talks about the Google office, yeah. But what you also have to know is what they really understand is, what are the skills of today and what are the skills of tomorrow? One of the most important skills of tomorrow is creativity and cognitive flexibility. For cognitive flexibility, they hire people like Holly. They hire people from the US. They are specialists in biophilic design because they want to improve, enable the people to work on these skills.
But doesn't that sort of polarize the labor market between the people who have these great jobs in great companies and the people who are, you know, sitting in factories churning out the...
No, I think it's just a matter of it's true. I think it's taking off. My kind of work is taking off more, as I said, with the management and team leaders and team building. But I'd like to see a company invest and say, Holly, come in and do something with the assembly line. So I think it's just a moment of changing the view of the CEOs and the people who are hiring, doing these kinds of jobs, the HR, who doesn't understand, you know. Opening up to these practices it's pretty new in Europe, you know. It's kind of become a household word in the States. If you don't have emotional intelligence training, then they think, ooh.
Yeah, but the States is also where they work harder and longer than anyone.
They work hard everywhere. I think that's more a problem of, as well, of the individual needs to. You know, I remember reading a story about, I think it was actually in India, and, no, I'm sorry. It was in, I don't remember which country it was in. But the idea was that it was in the 50s, 60s, like just in the turn of the from the end of the baby boomers, where if you left the work, if you left your office after 6 o'clock, you were considered to be probably not very smart, didn't get his job done today, he's still working, and doesn't care about his family, or maybe doesn't have a family. So it was looked at like, uh-oh, what's he doing still here? Or, well, more he than she, probably. And now it's completely different. We're responsible for changing this outlook of, you know, someone's still at the office after 7 o'clock. We should be going home and living our lives as well. And I think that the change is going to be happening with the millennials. So they're not going to be staying at the office after 8 o'clock at night. I think that it's just going to be different. And I think it's up for us to change those. I'd like to go back to the idea of, you know, why are you here at 6 o'clock? You should be home, living, having the time of your life.
But I also think that we talked about cognitive flexibility, emotional intelligence. You know, talent doesn't come in one shape or size, right? We cannot, you know, if where we're going to is a way that people need to be this or like that, or they need to be here, or they need that. That doesn't work, right? That's not inclusive. So the challenge is, and in offices where we can maybe do it better, how do we actually recognize the meaning of people's work and the output that they have rather than the way that they go about it? That is a challenge. It's always been the challenge. I remember when I started working 35 years ago, it was already the challenge, but now it's even bigger. Because we can't recognize people's work if we believe that it's only the way in which you do it that has value. It's got to be what comes out. And what comes out may be through a completely different process than, you know, from one person to the next.
But, I mean, I entirely agree. But when we were talking before the session, and you mentioned that, you know, you've been in the labor market, you know, you've been in the labor market for several decades, I'll be. But you mentioned that you know, over that time, productivity has, you know, the nature of your job has changed, the nature of work has changed, but that you're doing less. You know, computers can do quite a lot of the low value stuff that everyone used to have to do, but that the benefits of that have all been ploughed back into the company. You're still working just as hard as you ever did.
Yeah, I was sharing. It's 35 years, right? So I don't mind. I'm looking forward to my retirement. Yes, it's. If you think of all the maybe less, more routine work that's now been taken over by technology, and you think about even your own career, that time hasn't been given back to the worker. And I think what companies like Google have done, but it's not just Google, there are also companies who are great places to work and who are not Google, who are in more traditional environments. What they've done is they've given part of that time back to the worker to think, right? To take time. And there's an expression, I don't know how you say it in English, but my children, they always talk about they want, ils vont se poser. They want to, they're not going to rest. They're just going to put themselves somewhere, drop some, yeah. But the expression is literally physically of just putting yourself in one place and not moving. And I think that's the piece that we need to be able to give back to workers. They just put themselves in one place and not move, just for a little while.
Which leads neatly into something else we were talking about. I mean, which has come up with the mention of millennials as well, which is how this is going to be affected by age, especially the age of the workforce, especially over the coming decades. I mean, there's just our model at the moment is that people go to school, they go to university, we sort of stamp them with the skills we think they'll need for the next 40 or 50 years, and then set them loose. And it sort of feels like that's not a model which is really sustainable anymore, that we need to invest just as much in adult education to help people cope with the way the workplace is changing. Otherwise, you end up with a situation where the only people in the office who know how to use the latest tools are the 20-somethings.
I think it's important to start developing programs in companies where the, let's say, I don't know, the 50-plus, the Generation X and Baby Boomers are put into situations of you know, meeting communication. I mean, some sessions would be really interesting. I had a friend who did this in the States with the millennials and share their skills, understand a little bit, you gotta develop some lines of communication, because now I just hear about people putting that, our generation, saying, oh, those millennials, they're lazy, they don't want to do this, and, you know, they just want to go play. And I've got six, not at home anymore, but they're off in their world, and they're not, you know, lazy, and they do care. And yet the skills, they might go too fast at something. So, you know, our skills, our generation's skills, let's say, would be offering some life sense and bring that sense of advising and, gee, what I did in this career, because human nature doesn't change that much. We think it does, but actually the sense of what we learn in a life is this wisdom. And I think connecting the two generations, that bringing that gap together in companies, is going to be something really, really crucial. Plus the fact of our retirement age might be changing. And if these people are going to stay on in the workforce, I think we need to develop a way that their skills are recognized, and that with the millennials, that the two generations is kind of a bridge, so that we can understand and value the experience or the knowledge skills of both sets of groups.
We never build an office for an age and not for a gender. So in the past, and maybe not tomorrow. But to come from another point, maybe. So if you think these new corporates, and they are built by much more by purpose, and this purpose attract a community. So if you go to the news companies, it's more community driven. And the corporate culture is more holistic. It's not by the entrepreneur, but the founder of the company. It's done by the community. And this community has space on one hand side for the community, but on the other hand side for my personal authenticity and for my individual talent. So I think first step is provide a purpose. And if you provide a purpose, the people will engage. Because in ourselves, there are two things. We want to belong to a thing which is much more bigger than ourselves, family, community. And the other one, and that is a much more important, we want to be the entrepreneur of our potentials. Anybody in the space want to be the entrepreneur of the potentials. So the company has to provide that. That is really hard, because you give responsibility more to the employees in that fact, and also maybe time. And with this program, maybe you start also a program internal to educate them. And what I don't believe, it's not in terms of this change program, because if you don't provide a purpose, you can invest a lot in change management. It won't succeed. You have to provide a purpose.
Oh, I agree. That's beautiful. I agree 100%.
I get a bit, and it is beautiful. And I just, but you know, there's two realities about millennials, right? There's the millennials that are in the workplace that are changing the way we work, and I see a lot of millennials here. But there's also the fact that for young people in many countries, there's no access to jobs. You know, and we run reinsertion programs in the UK, for instance. I was talking to a young man, third generation without work, right? Three generations of people who hadn't gone through. And so there is an immense opportunity for corporations to invest in training of young people so that they can have access to work, because we're missing skilled workers, so we should be investing in that. And I would just like to make my pitch also for those who are not the ones that you see in the offices. And then I would add that once we have this diversity in the workplace, and it is what it is, there is one thing which is very different from one generation to the next, which is recognition. And it's not reward, it's not pay necessarily, it's the way in which we recognize people's work and people's value. And once again, I think when we talk about the potential of technology in the workplace, the ability to have differentiated, tailored recognition systems so that people can understand that not only does their work have meaning for them, but their work has meaning for the employer. That is very powerful. And I think that is going to be one of the trends in the future, being able to instantaneously, differentially recognize people's contributions.
Although there is also the danger that that leads to a culture in which people are sort of endlessly, like sort of exam culture in schools, where you're endlessly measured and the, you know, the bottom 10% performers are culled at the end.
That's why I'm not saying it's not reward. Reward is about performance. Recognition is about being able to do something that has value for the whole community. So that's why there's that slight differentiation.
And can I ask you a question, which actually you've sort of touched on from the audience, which is we've talked about just now about sort of how millennials, a word I kind of hate because I think that encompasses so many different people and so many different experiences. But about how young people sort of are valuing different things in the workplace. Is there evidence that the sort of working class culture that people from more traditional labouring occupations, that they are looking for different things from their work?
So once again, I'm very struck by the joblessness among a certain, in lots of countries among millennials. I'd also say that there's, whether it's working class or whatever, it's as if the social pact somehow was broken a generation ago. And this belief that you would go and work for a company and that you basically had loyalty right up front, that's gone. And that's actually whatever type of working environment. In fact, I had to laugh because we had in this program, we had a young man, third generation, jobless. We trained him and he was really good. He was really proud. He brought his family to the office so he could see what they could see him working. And then I find out he's resigned because he got headhunted. I'm saying, how can you headhunt somebody that we've all trained and so on? But yes, and so that notion that I'm going into a company and I'm going to stay there forever, yes, that's gone. And I think unless, as employers, we rebuild that loyalty and that trust, that will be gone for a long time.
And where do you think that comes from? Because from what I've learned, again, as not really working ever in a company, is that comes through the sense of meaning and purpose, as well as the leadership of the company, and what is that sense of authenticity and charisma there that people will, like Raphael said, go and follow and do it. I don't know if that's something that can be rebuilt. Is it something that's gone? Are we just going to work? I don't know. I'd like to know the audience, but are we going to go to work? Why? It's not only the paycheck, is it?
In many cases, it's for the paycheck still.
I don't know. What is the percentage? I'd really like to know if anyone has that statistic, OECD. But I don't know. I mean, I think people statistics. Now are looking for meaning in their lives, not only in their personal life. That's why I say the work-life balance is not really, I don't think, appropriate anymore, in the sense that we're all looking for meaning and we want to go to work and feel like what we're doing, we are contributing to something other than just paying our bills at the end of the month. And I think that if the company is giving that message that we're doing this for this reason, I think it would be fantastic. But I think it's more than just the paycheck. I mean, I know some people, it is just the paycheck at the end of the month, but how can we make their lives more rich? And this is a lot of things that I think the added value that I give is when I go into a company, these kinds of practices, people understand then and develop that interrelationship with others and understand that, life isn't just this, what is that, metro, boulot, dodo, that they can develop meaning in their lives, even if they're just going and they're bringing, they're serving the food.
Quite a provocative comment from on Twitter. Someone just pointed out we the title of the panel is Life, Time and Space, and all we seem to be doing is talking about work.
Okay.
Sorry, Raphael, did you want to come in on the last point?
That's interesting. Maybe there's no border. Yeah. Maybe the borders are less. So I don't make a difference between work and life. It's only the space where I am. So when I travel a lot, and sometimes I look out of the plane and think about, oh, what beautiful space. I go through the city, take a beer, and then I do some emails. But that's my privilege and type of my job type. So for me, and it wasn't border. I want to, why people leave? Because they have the opportunity that also great to have an opportunity to leave. And now the offer outside in terms of variancy, how the companies are, how the management is, how the colleagues are, is in huge cities bigger, sure. And if you are in the outback, like where I live, there's less work for maybe crazy minds. Yeah, I wouldn't match there. But there's an opportunity to leave. And maybe that is one reason. But sure, honestly, I don't believe that this work which exists today to create our life will exist in the next 10 years. And I think that is the biggest challenge, maybe also for our discussion also, the what would be in 10 years or in 15 years with all this repetition work. Yeah. And come back to what is of importance. You know Airbnb? The most rented spot for an Airbnb is not a chalet, it's not a motorboat, it's not a Manhattan, a penthouse. It is a tiny cabin in the Redwoods in California. It is a tiny cabin in the Redwoods in California. What is desirable for the people. And so, back again, I believe it's really easy to create a space in life, in work, for less money, where we are hardwired to. Yeah. Sometimes we are like machines. We do the job. We want to be professional. We don't want to cry at work. We want to be super correct. I think that isn't a solution.
Well, speaking of solutions, we have two very similar questions, so I'm going to take them together from... one was from Alfred Wong, and I can't see the name on the other. But the questions are, do blunt force work-life balance policies by big companies like investment banks trying to protect your weekend, I mean, do they actually improve quality of life? And also, the next question is, to what extent can some companies, i.e. investment banks, you seem obsessed with investment banks, actually fully adopt, brackets, culturally, not just on paper, these policies? So I guess those come down to implementation. Is this a thing? If you are a CEO, which possibly people in this audience are, and you decide after this inspiring discussion that you need to change the culture of your company, how do you go about that? Do you just say, is it one big thing that you need to do, like some big dramatic gestures to get the change through the company, or is it about hiring Holly and just getting her to sort of talk to everyone in the company? I mean, Sylvia,
First of all, I do think work-life balance makes people happier in their work, and I think therefore they work better. So yes, it does work. But the way in which I would answer it and answer your question as well is it's got to be authentic. And so when a CEO, first of all, a CEO doesn't change a culture, right? A CEO helps change culture, gives purpose and vision, but cultures are hard to change and it takes the whole company. But it's got to be authentic. And I can see it in myself. I have a terrible work-life balance, okay? And so if I pretend to my teams that I have a great work-life balance and they've got to be like me, I mean, forget it. It's not going to go any further than my desk. What I do is I say to people, look, I'm a bit of a bizarre animal. I like working. I tend to wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning with an idea. But I don't expect you to work that way because I want you to work in a way that's the most balanced for you. And just that, I can tell you changes, it can change the atmosphere in a whole office. And it's about being authentic and about saying the truth, but about recognizing that people have needs, that these needs need to be met.
But do you find that, you know, it helps if you make a couple of sort of big gestures, or is it just about making it a continuous process?
I mean, there are very, very simple gestures, and I don't know what Holly would think of them. I mean, for instance, I see my team's laughing here. I've stopped answering emails or sending emails on Sundays, right? So I just put myself on whatever mode it is that and people get it all on Monday morning. I mean, it's ridiculous, but you can't imagine the difference that that makes. I've done something which I did very naturally, but I work in a completely open space, right? My assistant thinks it's terrible because everybody hears my conversations, so I've got to learn to go. But the fact that people see me and see the way that I work and the fact that I see them and that we can have social interaction, that we can talk to each other, it's changed things dramatically. These are two very small things. Now, you need to have more structural things. You need to be able to have the ability for working mothers, I'm a working mother, to have flexible work-life balance. You need to be able to ensure that people aren't sneaking around and putting meetings in at 6 p.m. In Europe and 3 a.m. in Asia and so on. So there's discipline, right? But small gestures can make a lot of difference.
Okay, well, I guess I would just ask you, but I won't. I would like to ask you, well, if you're happy, you know, okay, that's your choice. I would wonder if I was working for you in the open space, I think I'd be slightly nervous. But again, as I haven't worked in companies, I don't really know, but that would make me feel slightly nervous because she's like, wow, working all the time. And plus, I don't like the idea of open spaces, and I think that it's going to change because there's too much noise. We cannot concentrate. So I think sometimes providing an open space when we need that social interaction, but everyone has to have a space to work. It's quiet, you know, and that they can just sometimes do nothing, just sit there and just be and think and not have someone looking at them and saying, oh, well, they're doing, you know. And I'm really against open spaces for all of the, you know, people working. We need something different. And the thing about emails, I think the thing about, I wanted to say something about the time and space thing that somebody mentioned before, but well, I'll stay on this issue. I really believe that authenticity starts by knowing oneself and understand. Then the second step of a good leader, I think, is being empathetic. And sometimes being empathetic means that I won't be the powerhouse work person in front of the other ones, because I think that could maybe lead off to them being a little bit like nervous. That would be the only comment since you asked me.
And on the issue of space, it helps that we have someone here who knows rather a lot about that.
First, back to this culture topic. Honestly, there are a lot of challenges in front of us to survive this endurance. The corporate culture is the last glue. It's like a magnetic field which synchronizes all employees. If this didn't exist, forget it. Believe me, the company will fail by all the challenges will come. That's really important. That is the last point which could be stable in times of uncertainty. If that didn't exist, you have no advice and you have no compass for the organization. In the other point, in terms of space, oh my God, that's a great time to create a lot of spaces. You can sit and work wherever you want, introvert, extrovert, loud, less loud, dense, super dense. It's up to the company. There is not one patent to create a concept. And what I don't believe is an office layer with a generic repetition that you think that model works in Paris, it works in London, it works in New York, it works in Manila, wherever. Forget this. Yeah. You have to be a curator for space, like for your home. Why we should do anything? We don't wear the same dresses. Why we should do the same spaces all over the world? Makes no sense. When I go to Italy, I want to take Italian food. I don't go to Italy to eat Erbsensuppe from Germany.
Good point.
Yeah. And just on the issue of work-life balance and gestures, it may be of interest. I was speaking to BBH, the advertising agency, and they basically stole something from Pixar, which is to have a thing called a notes day. They shut down their company for a day and just talked about their processes, about what was going wrong, what was going right. I mean, there was a whole sort of filtering process leading up to this, and you know, they got sort of everyone in the company submitted ideas, and then they filtered those down, and they, you know, and so they emerged with various recommendations, and one of them was this thing called maker time, which is that between 11 and 1, no one will have no meetings, and also generally just no meetings, but especially during this period, you know, is your meeting really necessary? And because they found that it often wasn't, and so, you know, that was a big bold gesture towards saying to, and you remind people about flexible working and all of the other things we've been talking about. But now, sort of 6 months, a year later, they're sort of thinking, okay, we've made that big gesture, but, you know, there are some people who are going, hang on, we're meant to be creative, and you're telling us between 11 and 1 is when you're going to focus and work. What if I want to be creative between 8 and 11, 8 p.m. and 11 p.m.? What if that's how my body clock works? So they're sort of now shifting back, having made the big intervention, they're now sort of thinking about shifting back towards, you know, now that people know it's okay not to turn up to meetings, they're going to sort of be a bit more flexible.
I have a bench learning example how people could be involved and to create their new surrounding. We do a lot of work for BMW, and the head of labor, he's also a second person board of directors. He was totally disappointed about how the architects and the consultants serve the company. So he told me, "Hey, Mr. Gilgan, nobody understands our workforce." And I said, "Why? If we build up a new production, we do a cardboard simulation." So they built up out of cardboard one-to-one the most important places of this manufacturing hall. Okay. And now we build up a cardboard office. Okay. So we have done that in 5 days with around 15 groups. So the groups come in a space, they find out of cardboard 40 workstations in an area. They get a little bit workshop before in advance, and then they had 3 hours time to build up out of cardboard their own environment. What happens? And most of the time, from 40 workstations, they take out around 10 to 12. We had GoPros on the roof, we take photos that we see what happens, and then they build out of cardboard their special things they need. That was really cool. Why? It was value-driven. We provide a purpose. It was about estimation. They make their own experience. It was about the glue. It was about a tribe. At the end of the day, we had in 1 week more results than maybe in 3 or 4 months of change things, booms, you know what I mean. Yeah. And that was fantastic. That was also a great experience for me. Yeah, how to enable the people if you give over responsibility.
I just wanted to comment because somebody made a very funny thing about they just realized, and when you just realize that this is not about outer space, yeah, doesn't actually mean outer space. I want to make a comment on that because when I first was invited to do this and I read the title, I was like, what are they talking about? So that same thing, but I guess when I thought of space, I was thinking first, actually not physical space, but inner space. And I thought, they invited me to talk about inner space. So I just want to maybe give a little kick on the sense of you know, we all have an inner space, but we're not really connected to it. So it's a kind of a personal, we all have our own password to this, you know, wifi inner space, but we're not taking advantage of it. And if we did spend more time to learn in it, so many different ways how to connect to that, whether it's you sit in the nature, whether you go swimming, whether you know, but your mind is just in the present moment and developing that sense of who you are. That's really where meaning comes. I mean, we maybe ask for the CEOs to give us meaning and purpose for our work, but actually I want me to decide what's my meaning, like what's meaningful for me, what's my purpose, why am I here, where am I leading my life to? And I invite you all in this, not outer space, but maybe to take a little, you know, inner road trip inside to discover this sense of inner space that we all have that is free.
Okay. Well, yeah. No, I'm English. We don't do it in a space.
That's not true. Can I add one more thing? The UK government, this is major. In October 2015, last year, they issued interparliamentary report called the UK Nation, UK, a Mindful Nation, where they came out a 40-page report by the government saying that we need to invest in mindfulness and emotional intelligence in 4 sectors, the businesses, health system, education, and prisons. So yes, the UK is, maybe you're not yet, but...
I'm just want to check with our minders that we've got about 20 minutes left, and it would be great to open it up for questions. If you feel shy, you can still fire them at us via WizEmbly. I promise to work them in. But I mean, the standard protocol: if you raise your hands, wait for the microphone to come, and then say who you are and where you come from, and then and we'll try to get through as many as possible. Please don't be shy. You're asking questions on this. Oh, yeah, sorry, down the front there.
Hi, my name is Gautam Krishnaraj from the Young Diplomats of Canada, and that was one of my delegates, so very proud of her for being semantic about the title. I'm working with the University of McGill on trying to create a student space that will breed innovation and be a space that brings together both educators, staff, and students. So we literally have an empty room, and all of the conversation has been open, like as much open space as possible. What are your, what would you guys give as input for creating a space such as this?
So my idea is, so in general, for me, one best of the last university buildings is from Heatherwick Architects, a guy from London, done in Singapore. It's called The Hive. Google it. Brilliant. To your question, I love this idea of the garage spirit. I would build a huge space like a garage, where you can do anything you want and where you can leave your work. And the next time when the other students come in, they see what happens yesterday. Ah, that was Tom. What had they done? So on this space should be quite flexible and a little bit in this rough style. So where you can really mark, where you can leave your marks, where you can work with post-its. But also do you have to have a digital that you have monitors that you can show up your work in a sudden and where you are super analog, maybe by machine, some by Lego bricks or by whatever. And on the other hand side, oh sure, also you have to provide a HoloLens. Yeah, or maybe the lens from Facebook, yeah, these far lens. But think about the garage spirit, and there's no place for generic or repetition work. So that what I do. I could provide you a text if you see it later. Yeah.
But what are you actually using this space for? What is the idea? I heard the three kind of teachers, students.
The idea is that it'll be a room for innovation. So right now, it's basically an old apartment that is across from the university that has been acquired. And we want to make it a room to play, a room to innovate. But we don't know necessarily how to design it. We've looked at the Harvard iLab, a couple of other places like that. But we want it to be something unique and special to Montreal, especially.
Yeah. Well, of course, I'm going to say that it would be fantastic to work the three intelligences, be able to have the space to work the body intelligence, the emotional intelligence, and the mind intelligence, so that there has to be a space that is able to for movement, quietness as well. And I agree with a lot of the Raphael's ideas as well. To people need to write on the walls, you know, that's kind of fun, and but always a space where you can, if you need to roll on the floor, you can, you know, you can kind of go work through a lot of different mind-body practices, which increase enormously the sense of connection with others and connection to yourself. And the connection to yourself is the body intelligence is where we connect to what? Gut instinct. Gut instinct is not mind, is not prefrontal cortex thinking. It's the insula. The insula is connected to the body. Body is giving us a sensorial information. Most of us are disconnected from that, by the way. And it leads to a sensual life and a full, meaningful life because we're living all our senses and we're getting into our creative mode, innovative mode. So that's why I would suggest those things.
I would tell you pretty much the same thing, very much aligned. Being, of course, more of a services-driven person, I would think about comfort. And comfort is not always design. That's always what I say to my clients. You know, it may look beautiful, but is it comfortable for a long time? And I would encourage you to think in your mind and to start imagining what are the moments of importance. You're bringing three stakeholders together. How do you want them to be together physically? What type of interaction? What is the moment of truth in the moment that you use that? And how should your space be designed around that? And then of course I would say make it very easy for the cleaning teams to clean. It's got to be well designed for that, because that's very important for comfort as well.
And free snacks, just to keep people in the room.
No, snacks is, it's, yeah.
Healthy snacks.
Healthy snacks so that your brain juices can flow. Yeah.
Thank you.
The lady down here.
Hey, my name is Zabine, and I'm here from New Zealand. I'm here on behalf of a leadership institute called ALEE. I have a question for you guys. There's so much talk about culture change because we're in a new generation, how to engage us in corporates, in society. There's a lot of talk about how different cultures needed to sort of get us engaged. What is your view on facilitating or expediting this cultural change? Just curious.
And can I ask the panel just to be quite brief with the answers from now on, just so we can get through as many questions as possible?
I don't know how to expedite cultural change except to be that change individually.
Okay. Anyone else? No, I meant slightly longer.
Can't top that.
So Raphael, and hoist by my own petard. Next.
Hi, my name is Marion Kramers. I work for a technology company, much smaller than Google, in a WeWork office in London. And WeWork is one of those places that tries to have several companies there and tries to sort of does the cross-pollination, and you have a lot of social events there. I hear they're now also looking into living spaces and all that. So space-wise, they're definitely experimenting and they're definitely trying to be ahead of the curve. Yet what I find working there amongst all these sort of well-educated young people is that, perhaps this is a British problem, I don't know, but that you find they're still socially very risk-averse. And keeping in mind that especially in cities you have a lot of single people as well that may not necessarily go home to a family because there is no family, because that's the kind of generation we are, I wonder what it would take for people, not individual people in their mindfulness, but people across teams and across people they encounter in other teams and other companies, to be less risk averse and to benefit much more from everything we have in our heads and to bring that to a society, a community, whatever it may be. And I'm very mindful as well that this would apply as well to the teams you work with at Sodexo and in manufacturing plants, for example. How do you sort of rise above, given the space and given the means, how do you rise above the social norms we've created and actually start interacting?
That's a really good question. Just because I'm from the UK, I'll take a stab at it. I think part of the problem, but not just in the UK, more generally, is the sort of it's just the structure of the economy now is quite winner takes all. You know, we're having fewer children, we're having children later. There's more. We want to get them onto the best jobs, and this is a completely other thing. But it leads into a style of parenting which is very much about, you know, exams and training them, and sort of, you know, not and smothering in some senses. And then but that kind of leads to a sort of sense of risk aversion. If you sense that you're in competition with other people, you're less willing to be creative and to try new things. And the other point obviously is that, you know, creativity comes from diversity. That the more different people you have in a space, the more the more different ideas and perspectives, the better. And maybe one of the dangers of WeWork and stuff, which are really fascinating, is that they'll end up with, you know, quite a lot of the same kinds of people gravitating there.
I'd throw it back to you. What's stopping you from being the risk taker to bring these things to WeWork organization? There's your answer. Be the change, you know, be the change you want to be in the world. There you go.
I have one short bench learning from WeWork. What WeWork has, they have community managers. And the community managers bring the community together. What would happen when in your company is a community manager who know the talents from the other ones? And you search your talent brother and your talent sister for a special skill. That makes it so really lovely what they have done. That was the reason why they grow. I was totally fascinated in 2009 or 2010 when I visited them first time in the US. Think about a community manager in your company and think about a mood manager in your company. That would be brilliant.
Exactly. And I add, and that person should be excellent in mindfulness and emotional intelligence. Whoa. That's it. I already have asked companies, let me train somebody in your company, somebody young in, you know, 20, 30, and this is definitely going to be a job tomorrow. What I'm doing now is going to be the community manager all wrapped up in one. It's in a really fun job, really great job.
So it's an interesting question about WeWork, because we started talking to them about different things. I think the model that you're describing and the reason why there's this problem of a shift, because they've designed the space to be a community space, because it's co-working, then the driver is the space. The driver is the asset. Whereas in an in a traditional office, the driver should be the purpose of the company, right? And so if you, the opportunity that you have is to create the space and the work to be able to contribute to that higher purpose of the company. So the question that WeWork came and asked us is, how do we create that when the space doesn't belong to a company? How do you create it? Because you all have different purposes. It's not just your social rhythms. I think it's because you're not united by that common purpose. So I don't have the answer. Hopefully we'll have it quite shortly for them. And we can test it in London, if you're in London, and you can tell us if it works.
We've got 10 minutes left. So if I can take a sort of two or three questions at a time, and then whoever feels most inspired can answer. So yeah, sorry.
Hi, I'm Lila Gazzolo. I'm from the Global Voices Australian Youth Delegation. We've noticed a real shift in companies going as a solution for work-life balance to include life into the workplace and, you know, to blend them both. My question is, do you actually think that's a solution, or if this just incubates or the problem further, because then social cohesion is now with the workplace again and we just find ourselves disenfranchised from the communities outside the workplace. So I'm wondering if you think that integration is a solution or if it's just exasperating the problem. Thanks.
Cool. And has anyone else been given a microphone in the... yeah, no. I mean, please, if you just give microphones to people without my approval, because it'll just speed things up a bit.
My name's Kate Dunbar, and I work for Ascent Compliance as their subject matter expert on human trafficking. So I look at issues of forced labour, particularly around the world. Throughout the session, I've been sort of thinking, how does this apply to a factory worker in Bangladesh or someone working in the shrimping and fishing industry in Thailand? And I don't want to have that divide. So I've been thinking, you know, as long as people don't have good pay, human rights, then this is, you know, this question of sort of lifestyle doesn't apply, but I want to believe that it does. So how would you work in those contexts? What would you be your solutions in contexts where basic sort of things haven't been ticked off? You know, people are not getting good pay, people don't have access to healthcare. Is there still space for all the things that we've been talking about? I'm sure there is. And how do we go about, you know, looking at these issues when other bigger problems haven't been fixed? Can they be done together?
Great question. And one more, and then I'll launch it.
Hi, my name is Tram. I'm from France. I'm an entrepreneur. I'd like to ask you a question related to startups, because I co-develop startups. The speed is very, very quick. And actually, the organization searches itself. So when this organization searches itself, what would you recommend for the startup founder relative to the teams as it changes to actually keep, you know, common values, to retain them? Because, as you know, the talent war also applies for startups.
Sure. So, Sylvia, so we've got, yes, the blend of work and life, the startups, and whether any of this, well, how we can apply it to places which don't have juice bars and the rest of the paraphernalia.
So I'd like to address a question on the Bangladesh manufacturing sites. I have a lot of my business is in Asia and in places where we know that there may be forced labor, human trafficking, child labor. You know, honestly, as an outsourcer, we can't talk about quality of life if that's not the basic rights to life. So we choose not to work where it's just not respected. Where there's a minimum, whether it's a legal minimum or a compliance, I think there's a lot that can be done in terms of health and safety to start off with. You know, we forget about it in industrialized world, but a lot of people go to work with heavy machinery and no safety shoes, right? So how can we do that? We work a lot with Sodexo as well on our people, so that the entry level work that they can have by working in these environments is also a social elevator. And very honestly, one of the things that we work the most on, which I'm the most proud of, because I think it helps in those situations, is to be able to provide housing for people who come to work on manufacturing sites from villages. Because the biggest issue that you have is you may be paid correctly, but not enough to have housing, and then you start a vicious circle of you know, going down to different things. So yes, there are things to be done, but the bare minimum has got to be respected. It's not possible otherwise.
And guys, would you like to chip in on that, or I do the other two questions?
Yeah, I just want to add that just to that, I've I've spent a lot of time in Bihar, a state in India, which is the poorest state in India. And I wouldn't actually want to try to teach them anything because I think they're quite spiritual and a lot of deep respect for their, even though they earn nothing, they are completely different from the West. I don't know if I wouldn't even dare to teach any of these things to many people who are poor but rich.
And on the other questions, any thoughts?
I only would recommend go on the internet, Google an article from Alejandro about his idea of the Venice Biennale, and you will find some answers regarding to your questions.
Okay. Anyone want to chip in on the other questions, or are we?
Very quickly on the integration. I'm fairly pragmatic. Things are what they are, and I find there's such a desire, especially in young millennials, to be able to open up to the community and to integrate in the community through their workspace. That yes, it is. It's important. It's something that has value, and it's something that we should be studying.
Okay, and I think we can squeeze in one final round of questions with very short questions, very short answers. If anyone's got a microphone.
Hello, can you hear me? Yeah, my name is Patricia Cerda. I come from Chile. I came here to study, and finally I work as a trainer. I get married, I have a boy, a beautiful boy. And my question is about the recognition. As a teacher, as a trainer, in the educational field, we need a lot of recognition. A lot of we pass a lot of time preparing our course, and then to face-to-face teach. But you talk about the recognition in the field of the entrepreneur, la société. Sorry. And but how we can use maybe our language to improve the recognition? I said in the maybe as we said most oftenly thanks and to smile is just a better way to improve our life and to be more happy. Well, just simple thing maybe. Yeah. But I would like to know your opinion.
Yeah. I expect Hollywood.
Totally, being grateful for what we have. I mean, that's probably the first lesson I learned in yoga training years ago was learning how to be adaptable at everything I have in the moment, and santosha, the sense of contentment with what I have at this moment. So I agree 100%. Try not to always look outwards for recognition. Try to find it within yourself first, because you might not ever get it outside.
And just two more questions, and then I'm afraid we're done. Anyone? Okay, well, in that case, I can't see. Sorry, yeah. Sorry, my eyesight.
Hello, I'm Elsie Fuvel. I'm a real estate professional. So in real estate, space, time, and life is all connected. We tackled the question of open space. Open space is a trend for several years now because also it's a cost factor. So it's less expensive because you can have more people in a smaller space. So I would like to ask you the question for Sodexo. Are you using more open space also for these kind of issues? And are the advantages of open space then better than the inconvenience? And on your side, what do you see? You said open space is not the ideal solution. What else do you see as a better organization of space? And on your side, maybe, are you developing more objects or furniture or projects for open space? Or how do you see the trend? Thank you.
Okay, well, left or right?
Okay, so I'll go really quickly. Personally, I detest open space, right? But the fact is that we have to choose often whether we use money on space or whether we use money on employees. And so when I discuss it with my clients, when we talk about it in Sodexo, I think if that commitment is fair, which is yes, we're saving money on space, but then we can reinvest it in the employee. And I have clients, for instance, who commit to reinvesting 20% of their savings directly onto the employee experience, then I think it's a fair deal.
Okay, and
can I just say in 15 seconds, I think that I have a benefit of open space. Let's show you. So let's be in open space right now. I ask everyone just to sit. Just pick up and then straight spine. Advantage of open space is that we can be together as a group. So I ask you just to close your eyes for a moment. Take a deep breath in up your spine. Hold this deep breath in. And as you exhale, have a little smile on your face and exhale. Okay, one more breath in and feel the energy of the whole group together. Another exhale and a big smile on your face. I don't think I have time for a third, but this is a benefit of open space. You can get your team together and work and feel the energy. Voila.
Rafael, can you top that or should we?
In 10 seconds. The space for tomorrow is dedicated to the people, so it's a curated office. So be a curator, take out this kind of furniture or colors, materials you love, and sure, we are still work on new settings, and these new settings are much more dedicated, like if you think how you can orchestrate talents, yeah, how you make it much more flexible, and how you make it much more in a do-it-yourself way that the people can take over the products.
Okay, well, thank you so much. We're definitely out of time now. If you're interested, I'll be presenting my book, The Great Acceleration. So it's written down here. This is in the Forum Discovery Lab at 4 o'clock. Via the same tool you use to ask questions, you can give us feedback and rate our performance. Thank you so much to the panelists for a fascinating discussion, and thanks to you for making it work.